I am insecure. Really, I'm insecure. I hide behind my outgoing personality, my laughs, my encouragement, my loving and thoughtful personality to hide the fact that I'm insecure. I'm born and raised in Miami, so it's not a very hard place to be insecure. I have the most amazing family. I have a younger sister. She is the artsy one. She's gorgeous. And truly anything she touches, it turns to gold. It's amazing. I have an amazing older brother. He is my role model. He is the person I look up to the most. I've had those star eye emojis for him since I was born. I have two amazing parents who are still together, and I'm very proud of. My mom is my best friend. She is my number one encourager. She's the cheerleader you want on your team. She's the voice in the back of my head that I always hear telling me I can do and be anything that I want in life. And I really do believe that. I have an amazing father. He is the definition of grit and hard work. Anything that he sets in front of him, any goal that he puts for himself, he bulldozes his way through until he gets it. But growing up in my house wasn't always perfect. It was hard sometimes. You see, my father, he owned two nightclubs. So his hours were work all night and sleep all day. So as three little ones, on a Saturday morning when all we want to do is play and watch cartoons and just be kids, we were always told to, shh, we have to keep it down. Your father's sleeping. I used to look at that master bedroom door and I used to see it and be afraid of it, to be honest, because I knew if I woke up my father, there's a 50-50 chance that he would either be extremely mad and his rage would go from 0 to 100, or he'd be so happy to see us and he'd be the best dad ever. I'd like hope for those memories where we'd be in the pool or we'd be playing Crocodile 911. It's a game we made up and it was like the best game ever. And I loved those memories, but unfortunately my insecurity started because I didn't know where I stood with my own father. And it was a constant uncertainty of, is he going to be happy today? Is he not? Am I good enough for him? Why doesn't he encourage me the way my mother does? And I know this built a real foundation of insecurity because it only went on from there. You see, I'm also insecure about my looks. I have this very specific memory of going with my brother to one of his modeling shoots. He was the perfect baby. He was a beautiful baby model. And my mom would bring me along to go on his photo shoots. We would be on the beach in Kennedy Park and he'd be with, you know, some other fake family and they would look perfect, end up on the Kmart ads and just look amazing. But I remember feeling, even so little, I must've been 3. Why don't they want to take my picture? Why can't I be the one in front of the camera? Why can't I be the model? I didn't know what model meant, but I knew what they were doing and I wanted it. I'm also insecure about my weight. I have a memory in 4th grade. We were doing PE class inside. I think it was raining or something. And I remember we had everything set up. We had the scale. We had that BMI claw pincher thing. We had people doing sit-ups and push-ups. And we were all writing down our records. We were seeing what each student had. And I remember so vividly standing on that scale and being so disappointed with the number that was looking back at me. It was 10 or 15 pounds heavier than most of the boys and girls in my class. Everyone was talking about their weight. It was like they were proud of it. They were like, oh, I'm this. Oh, yeah, me too. And I remember the moment I stepped off the scale that they were probably going to ask me what my weight was. And I so badly didn't want them to ask me that. I'm like, please, oh, can I just disappear right now? Can they not ask me? And I know they probably did. And whoever asked me, I probably lied to them. But it just reminds me back to those photo shoots and feeling like I was chubby or feeling like I wasn't good enough. It reminds me of being back with my father, just feeling like, why aren't you telling me I'm good enough? So it's this thread that's going throughout my life. I'm also insecure about reading. I have never enjoyed reading. It's just not my thing. I know it's my mom's, it's my brother's, it's my grandfather's, but for me, it's always been so hard to just sit and read. And because of that, school was really hard for me. School and reading out loud and having students hear me read out loud, that was such an insecurity for me. I remember in fifth grade, specifically, there was this memory where we were sitting down in social studies class and we were learning about the Revolutionary War. And the teacher said, okay, well, we're going to read as a class. Each student will take a paragraph. And the anxiety, it just rushed over me. I started sweating. I would sweat through my uniform. I was so nervous. But it's happened to me before, so I knew what to do. I counted how many paragraphs were, or how many students were before me, so I knew how many paragraphs were before me. I would practice my paragraph two or three times. And then every time, there would be one overachieving student who would read two paragraphs and completely throw off my practice. And I knew that was gonna happen. It always happened. I should have read more. But it was such an insecurity for myself to hear myself reading out loud. It was like an out-of-body experience. The first sentence would be strong, and little by little, it would go away. You could hear the shake in my voice. You can hear just the insecurity screaming out of me. So I'm not good at reading. I'm not good at reading out loud. I'm not good at test taking either. Test taking for me was so difficult. And the one test, the one with the most pressure, is the SAT, right? This is the one test that is pretty much gonna just tell me what's gonna happen with the rest of my life. Am I gonna be a failure? Am I gonna get into a great college? Am I gonna go into a college with my friends, or am I gonna be proud of this college? There was just so much pressure with this one test. And I remember I had a very good friend in high school who told me about this one pill called Adderall. And he basically described it the same way I listed off my insecurities. He described it to check off those boxes. You'll be able to sit down and read. You'll be able to comprehend what you're reading. You'll be able to focus like you've never focused before. A circus can be happening around you and you'll be able to really focus on what's in front of you. He didn't say, but later on I figured out that it also helps control and suppress your appetite. It helps control your weight. So it was like all these insecurities I've dealt with my whole life is all being answered by this one pill. And I remember I was not a very, I'm gonna go party this weekend, I'm all loose and fun. In high school, I was pretty straightforward. I didn't encourage my friends to smoke pot or do anything too crazy. Actually, if I found out they were smoking weed, I would break up with them. Like, I would be like, listen, this friendship isn't gonna go any further. I was pretty serious about it. So it's just interesting reflecting through this process to see all my insecurities led me to be so desperate that I wouldn't even do research on such an addictive drug that I said yes to it right away. He described it. It sounded perfect. It sounded like it answered all my problems. I said, yes, please. I would love to take it for the SAT. And I remember I took it the morning of the SAT and it hit me right as my test hit my desk. And it was like the answer to life. Everything just fell into place. I could not believe that I was able to look down and read through the first page and not even, you know, look up at my neighbor, see what else someone else is doing, because that's what most of my tests look like. And I just remember thinking, like, wow, what is this? So fast forward, I did well on my SAT. I got into the honors college, and I had a long list of projects and papers. And now this program is so hard that I feel that pressure again. I feel like I'm not enough. I feel if I don't have this pill, then how am I gonna succeed? Because I've convinced myself the only reason I got there is because of the pill. So I went to my friends who I knew had been prescribed Adderall. I asked them, how did you do it? Who were your doctors? What do I have to say? I did get tested and the process was pretty speedy, but before I knew it, I had a prescription for myself. And I didn't know it then, but that was the beginning of a 7-year battle and addiction with Adderall. I told myself, you're only gonna do this for 2 years. You only need it for the Honors College. And then before I knew it, the Honors College was over and I got into this amazing mission trip. It was like a dream come true. And I told myself, okay, no, I won't need it for the mission trip. But then I had to fundraise $16,000 to get on the mission trip. So I started a brownie business, except the brownie business was doing so well that the only thing that was gonna keep me going through that whole process was the Adderall, was my crutch that I've been leaning on for the past 2 years. So then I told myself, okay, so after I fundraise the brownies, then I'm going to stop taking the Adderall. But then I was chosen in my mission trip to be the head of the finance, the person to oversee 42 people and their budgets in 11 countries with 11 currencies. And then I told myself, no. I have to be efficient. I have to be reliable. I have to take this job seriously. So I told myself, I'll take it. Then when I got back, I finished my last 2 years of school. I needed it for school. There was just a constant battle of wanting to quit, but not being able to. And it all stems back to not feeling enough, about putting all of my security in a pill, in a substance that was addictive, and I never even did research on it. I remember one time in church, our pastor was up and he was talking about our vision and the goals we were setting for the next year. And one of the goals was to open a recovery program. And that was like music to my ears. That was the best thing I could have ever heard. I felt like God was speaking to me so clearly in that moment. This is gonna be the program that I help you, that I truly am gonna walk you through this process, and you're gonna do it right. You're gonna stop depending on Adderall. You're gonna walk through your insecurities. You're gonna really, really give these insecurities over to me and find your security in me. And the Tuesday that it started, I was there, thank God. And I've been going ever since. I'm happy to say that I am 10 months sober. Thank you. That I'm so, so proud and thankful to God that there is a space of people who not only are open and vulnerable about their problems, but they want to hear about your problems. They want to encourage you. They want to lift you up and point you to God. They want to just make you the best person and truly empower you to run after the purpose that God has set before you. And I am so, so blessed to be a part of this journey. I know I would not be on this stage 10 months ago, even with the Adderall. I would have said no to something like this because I wouldn't be proud of my story. I wouldn't be proud of what I was dealing with. You see, I put my security in a substance instead of putting my security in God. And that's where everything went wrong. Because now I'm working through and finding my security. I feel secure just being up here and speaking to you guys now. And I just want to challenge you. I want to end this with a call to action to really dig deep and reflect on what your insecurities are. What are you putting your security in that you should be giving your security to God? It is so amazing to just be able to share this with people. It is the best gift ever. And I really do hope that you take that and you challenge yourself and you find someone to share your story with. Thank you for letting me share. Yeah.